I want to thank Restoration Plaza for allowing us to use this gorgeous, newly renovated Billie Holiday Theater for tonight's gathering. I also want to thank our co-sponsors, New York City Public Advocate Letitia James, New York City Council Member Robert Carnegie, and New York State Assembly Member Tremaine Wright for partnering with us to make tonight's conversation possible. We certainly could not have a conversation like this tonight without their input or their involvement, and you all tonight are essential to making sure that this is a fruitful conversation for us to begin with, not end with, but for us to start with, right, as we go forward. Just briefly, I want to let folks know a little bit about the Commission on Human Rights. How many folks here are familiar with it? Wow, that's awesome. That's a lot more hands than we get when we go into a lot of different communities. So there's probably a lot I don't have to tell you, but let me tell you a little bit about it just in case there's parts of the Commission you don't know. The Commission has two main bureaus. We have a Community Relations Bureau that is charged with being in communities in all of the five boroughs. And so we have community service centers in each of the five boroughs where they're charged with working on the ground with different communities, different constituent groups on issues that are relevant to the human rights law, that are relevant to human rights and discrimination and harassment. They do workshops, they do trainings, they have conversations with people in the community about what their needs are, how we can help connect them with other government resources, what types of discrimination or harassment people are seeing in their communities. That's actually the bureau that spearheaded tonight's event. We also have a civil law enforcement function. That's our law enforcement bureau. And the law enforcement bureau is there to take in complaints of discrimination and harassment from the public. So if you're experiencing discrimination or harassment in New York City, and we have jurisdiction over basically all areas of city living, whether it's in employment or housing or public accommodations while you're trying to access businesses or services. We have jurisdiction over something called discriminatory harassment, which is also something like a civil form of hate crime. And we also have jurisdiction over bias-based profiling by law enforcement. So virtually all areas of city life, if you're experiencing discrimination or harassment, we want to hear about it. And over the last 2 years, we've aggressively investigated claims of discrimination and dramatically increased the number of investigations that we've conducted. In 2016 alone, I can tell you that, you know, inquiries into the agency increased by over 60%, 60. So that's a lot, right? And in that same year, I can tell you that we increased the number of investigations into race and color discrimination by 32%. So we filed more than 230 cases alleging some sort of race or color discrimination in 2016 alone. Racial discrimination made up the second largest area of complaints at our agency, comprising more than 15% of all claims. And most of those claims, 67% of those claims, were filed by Black New Yorkers. So we've also significantly increased our outreach to communities that have been targeted for this type of discrimination and bias. That's part of why we wanted to put this program together. So if you've experienced or you've witnessed any sort of racial discrimination or any other type of discrimination or harassment, we want you to call 311, ask for human rights. You could also reach us directly. If you call 718-722-3131, you'll be connected with us directly. Relationship building, I think, is very important. You have to know that we're going to act on your claims if you call us. And with that in mind, I want all the staff for the Commission on Human Rights, if you're here right now, please raise your hands. Keep your hands up if you're with the Commission on Human Rights. Frank's over there too, and I have some folks out in the front. Keep them up. They're also the folks wearing the blue lanyards that say New York City Commission on Human Rights. So I don't want you to leave today if you haven't received at least one of their business cards. Hopefully you're going to leave with two or three of them, but you need to leave with at least one of them, and some of you already have mine. Because you have to know that we are responsible to you, and if you call us, you're actually going to get a human being. So know who these human beings are. They know that they are responsible to you. You know, we're also very conscious of the fact that race matters. Racism is sadly alive and well in New York City and throughout the country. We don't live in a post-racial society, and we need to talk about the impact of racism on our communities and upon the rights of New Yorkers. We're also aware that, you know, there are communities that have sometimes been isolated from important news announcements and from key information that they need to access city government and city services. And that's why the Commission on Human Rights has focused its media outreach on ethnic and community media. And in the last year, up to 80% of our media ad buys were in ethnic and community media, because we know that we have to communicate with communities the way that they're used to getting information. So outlets like Brooklyn Daily Eagle, Brooklyn Paper, Caribbean News, Caribbean Life, Amsterdam News, Voz Hispana, El Diario, El Correo, DNA Info, and News 12 in Brooklyn. If you receive your news from other sources and you want to say, hey, Commission on Human Rights, what about this paper? Or think about this way of sending out your information, let us know. Let us know, we can consider it. We've also been putting out our posters, our multilingual posters in different areas, in different neighborhoods, places like bodegas and laundromats and nail and hair salons, barbershops, places we know where people go frequently and where people go also with their families. We want to be out there. We want you to have constant information from our agency, so if you are experiencing discrimination, you know how to reach us. We need to engage all of you, and we want to ensure that you have rights as a New Yorker. That's why we also launched our You Have Rights NYC campaign. I'm really, really, really hoping that many of you have seen this campaign either on subways or train stations or social media. We also have videos that accompany this campaign. How many of you have seen them? Excellent. This crowd is just, be still my heart. I'm so happy. Thank you. That's great. And, you know, that's also why we're hosting tonight's event, because we want you to all to know that this is an important conversation for us at the Commission on Human Rights. We want this to be the first of many conversations, and we want to be able to talk about this and some other issues. And so with that, I'm going to hand it back to Frank. But please, again, if you haven't met folks from our agency, please introduce yourselves. They're going to be coming up to you as well and introducing themselves. And I thank you again very much for coming out tonight. I'm always grateful when folks come out to our events, because I know that everybody has busy lives and busy schedules. You have families, you have faith communities, you have children, you have jobs, you have many other things calling you. And the fact that you're cutting out some of that time to actually spend time with us is very meaningful to me and to us. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner. All right, that's a lot of information, so I hope you all know that the Commission on Human Rights is a resource to you all. So very happy about that. We're going to jump right into our conversation, and I have the distinct pleasure of just introducing to you all our panelists, the people who are going to be really driving this conversation. But before we do that, as the commissioner said, she said we are in the middle of a campaign that we launched called You Have Rights NYC. So everyone, I want you to grab your phones. If you're on social media, if you're on Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook, whichever social media, when you hear something profound, something you liked, if you just want to share the event, you can tweet, snap, you know, put a picture on IG, put a status on Facebook, and put hashtag You Have Rights NYC. It's hashtag You Have Rights NYC. So I hope you all just, you know, do that. I'm going to be on the side checking my timeline on everything and seeing, you know, who's tweeting, who's really getting the message out there. Because when people ask, when people say, I should have the right, we want them to know you do have the right. All right? Good. Right now, our first panelist that we're going to introduce is Michelle Laguerre. Michelle Laguerre is a native of Flatbush in Brooklyn. She is a social worker who currently works at the Jewish Board of Mental Health. Previously, she worked at the Sage Center for GLBT Elders in New York City. Michelle still resides in Brooklyn. Can we give Michelle a round of applause? Awesome. Our next panelist is Minister Kirsten John Foy. Minister Kirsten John Foy was born in Crown Heights and was raised in Central Brooklyn. Kirsten is a product of the New York City public school system, having graduated from Brooklyn Technical High School, as I, and attended CUNY's Brooklyn College. Kirsten is currently the Northeast Regional Director for the National Action Network, a national civil rights organization headquartered in New York City and founded by Reverend Al Sharpton. Kirsten has also worked in New York City and state governments. He worked in New York City government as Director of Intergovernmental and Community Affairs for then public advocate Bill de Blasio. Kirsten is a licensed Pentecostal minister and currently resides in Bedford-Stuyvesant with his wife and their three children. Can we give Kirsten a round of applause? Our next panelist is Rabbi Bob Kaplan. Rabbi Bob Kaplan is currently the founding director of the Center for Community Leadership, a division of the Jewish Community Relations Council of New York, JCRC, the central coordinating and resource body for 62 major Jewish organizations in the metropolitan New York area. Rabbi Kaplan is called upon by the nonprofit and government sectors as an expert and consultant in the arena of diversity, community building, leadership development, coalitions, and intergroup relations. Rabbi Kaplan serves as a member of Mayor Bill de Blasio's Interfaith Advisory Committee and the New York City Department of Education's Diversity Council. Can we give a round of applause for Rabbi Bob Kaplan? And our last panelist and facilitator is Kai Wright. Kai Wright is editor and host of WNYC's Narrative Unit and features editor for The Nation magazine. Kai's reporting and writing has focused on racial justice, economic inequality, healthcare, and sexuality. He is the former editorial director of Color Lines and a longtime fellow of the Investigative Fund at The Nation Institute. Kai lives in Brooklyn. Ladies and gentlemen, can we give a round of applause for Kai Wright? Let's dig deep into the conversation, and remember, hashtag YouHaveRightsNYC.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for joining us. Can we start by just getting a sense of, raise your hand if you live in Bed-Stuy. Oh, wow, okay. So we've got a Bed-Stuy crowd, so that's good to hear. This is sort of a bittersweet anniversary for me. A year ago, next week, I moved out of Bed-Stuy. I lived here for a little over a decade. As I was telling my panelists before we got started, it was a reminder of just how bad things are at this point. The fact that my partner and I are by any measure amongst the most privileged people in New York City economically. Many of us don't think of ourselves that way in the city. But the reality is we're a two-person household with the income we have and no children. We're enormously, enormously privileged. But when we got to when it was time to move out of our apartment that we'd been in for about a decade, both looking at rentals that were about the same size, and it's time for us to buy something, move on to life. It was a comical idea that we would do something and that we would stay in this neighborhood. And so we moved away. And if that is true for me, we are truly, truly in a crisis. And so we want to talk about how we got there, what is the contour of that crisis right now, and hopefully what can be done about it. And I think I will start with the other Bed-Stuy resident on the panel, Minister Foy. Maybe you can give us a sense of what's at stake here, and specifically, we have to name it from the jump, around race. What is at stake for Black Bed-Stuy in this moment?
Well, I think can you all hear me? Do I need to move this thing closer?
Feel free to grab your mics.
You don't want a Pentecostal preacher to grab the mic.
Works that way with rabbis too.
This was a good idea. What's at stake for Bed-Stuy is the same thing that's at stake for Harlem. Same thing that's at stake for Southeast Queens, the same thing that's at stake for every middle class community of color, Black community in the city, and of course across urban America. What we're seeing now are the results of a decades long plan to take New York City and make it a premium product, make it a premium global capital. And what that meant was that the people that were holding New York City down for all those decades when nobody wanted to have anything to do with us were going to be the ones to suffer this new wave of global popularity. So you had Giuliani come in, be the bulldog, drive down crime, put the colored folks in place, bring in investment. You had the billionaire come in after him with a development vision to take New York City, what was left of the undeveloped and underdeveloped New York City, and develop it, carve it up, give it to all of his real estate buddies to build up. And what we're seeing now is the result of all of that. Two decades of conservative rule is now culminating in the whitewashing of New York City. Now, I say that hoping to offend some and not offend others. The reality is New York has always been open to people. But the people who were here when times were hard can no longer enjoy the benefits of living in this city. And that is unacceptable. And that's why you're seeing this uprising of Brooklynites and people all across the city pushing back against this wave of development.
If it's unacceptable, you're saying folks who can no longer be part of a community they built. But to just put one more final step on that, what does that mean? What is at stake for black people in that?
Well, I think what's at stake for many black people are their legacies. You know, in Bed-Stuy, you have brownstones that were owned by grandmothers and great-grandmothers who are no longer being able to afford to maintain their properties, or their properties are being stolen from them. So you have a community like Harlem that is pushing back against the real estate industry's intent on changing the name of Harlem. Now, if there's any community name that is sacrosanct and sacred beside Bed-Stuy, it's Harlem. So when the real estate industry decides that it is more profitable to jettison the history, to jettison the culture, to jettison the people in the name of profiteering, then what's at stake is our very culture. Harlem and Bed-Stuy are cultural capitals of black America. We're just not communities, we're cultural and economic capitals. So what's at stake is the heart of our culture. And that's what we're going to be fighting, and what we have been fighting, and will continue to fight again.
Michelle, the minister mentioned the grandmothers and folks. So you have worked a lot with seniors.
Yes, I
who
have.
Are particularly in the middle of this. Can you talk a little bit about what they're seeing and why they're so central to this process?
So as a social worker, I do a lot of what they call field visits, home visits. And I've been serving the community of New York City for maybe over 20 years. And in doing my home visits, what I have noticed both with the seniors in Bed-Stuy and in Harlem, in one particular incident, I saw one of my clients, we're meeting, maybe three or four calls. Someone's calling her about her home. And the thing is that many of the terminology, many of the ramifications of selling, refinancing, whatever it is, it may not always be something that a senior is completely savvy with. And the targeting and the direct messaging and the direct intimidation or harassing, if you will, about their homes. And for some seniors, it may sound like a good idea. You know, maybe I can't maintain my home anymore. Maybe I'm all alone, and maybe I need someone to come and provide me with the health care, and refinancing or whatever will provide me with the income to do that. But the thing is, what's happening is that there's a displacement of this older adult, this older black African-American, Caribbean, older adult who has spent their lives in their community. So therefore, once they're displaced, where do I go to church? Church is even further for me, you know?
the grocery store that's always known me, the senior center that I'm used to going to. Now all of that's changed. And if I stay in the community, can I afford going to the grocery? Can I afford going, you know, shopping for whether it's clothes or, you know, medical supplies, whatever it is, the things that I need? Does this community, does it support our older African-American legacy, the generation that built the community? Does it support them both physically, mentally, and spiritually? And what we're looking at right now is that across the board, with this new gentrification, those social structures that support our community are also falling by the wayside.
As in the things that folks are using to keep their lives together in
the first instance. Like, for example, I mean, if you notice, you used to go to Fulton Street and just hail a cab. You know, now they're all green cabs. You know, they're Uber. You know what I mean? The accessibility is not the same anymore. For doing laundry, or if you were to, again, go to the corner store, all of those things, they're now gourmet delis. And, you know, the prices are increasing. So when you think about that, even if you could afford the rent, if it's low income, can you afford the things
that I think of when you're describing that, I think of a woman we interviewed in our podcast who had a few strokes, was a senior citizen in East New York, and they was getting daily harassment about selling her home, and I asked her why would she not sell? You know, you can get some good money here. Why wouldn't you do it? And she was saying that because, you know, she manages to walk to and from church every week. She gets around and she's disabled, but she is leads a fully independent life within her 5-6 block radius. And she said, because if I fall on the street, I know somebody will see me and know who I am and come get me.
Yes.
And which I thought was quite powerful. Rabbi, you were nodding trying to get in there when we were talking about this. So just go ahead.
So, I'm born and raised in Brooklyn, and originally in Canarsie. And one of my early memories of this particular community is that what I used to do when I went to Brooklyn College, I'll share that in common, is I used to drive a taxi. We talked about that change. So, on Sundays, when you drove a cab, you couldn't make any money driving in the streets of Manhattan, so I did something called the church runs here in Bed-Stuy. Now, for a couple of the reasons that you said, about the growth of Uber, the growth of technology, and the growth of who's living in the community and how they transport themselves and how they see transportation has changed radically. Along with new folks living in community comes new culture, new ethos, new ways of looking at things. I'm not quite sure I could have drove my cab in the modern Bed-Stuy and do a church run and get people to get in my cab and go for that short hop to the church, because so many of the folks that I know in the faith community are, well, we're just seeing the continual diminution of their congregations. So what was once literally the cornerstones of the community, I don't want to single out any particular church here or any particular house of worship in the community, where they used to have 1,000 people showing up on a Sunday morning, they now have 250 or 300. Because unless you're part of the economic engine, and it's an engine, and engines go forward, that's just what they are. Unless you're part of that economic engine, then you're left behind, and you can't afford to live in the community. So, yeah, communities change. Canarsie that I grew up in, where there was 21 synagogues, you know, as I was a kid, it just isn't there anymore. Things change, I get it. But the question is, do people who are sort of marginalized anyway get more marginalized so they can't even afford to live in a city and participate in this incredible, what I think New York's a really incredible place, and live in Brooklyn, which is an even more incredible place?
Well, and as you say, things change, but people change things too. This is not just a passive process. This is an actual active thing that's occurring. So let's talk a little bit about the ways in which the change is happening and what's happening to folks. Michelle mentioned, we talked about seniors getting harassed. to sell their place. What are some other ways that people are being pushed out? Minister Foy, what are you seeing in Bed-Stuy in terms of how the change occurs?
Well, I think, you know, this, an excellent segue. You mentioned this is not a passive phenomenon. It's in fact an aggressive phenomenon. The problem is not that there is change. The problem is that the change is being forced on the people that have sustained the community for decades. So it's not as if the community has exercised self-determination and invited 30,000 people, as you say, into their community overnight to change the complexion of the economy and the housing market and all of this other stuff. A lot of this change is being forced onto these communities, and there's no self-determination. So when you have community boards who are voting down big projects, and you have council people who are saying no to big projects, but the developer still knows that come November, after the election happens, the conversation is reignited, and people are not stupid. People know that you're not going to put $200 million on the line and then push that to the side because a couple hundred black folks are upset. See, the problem is, and this may be a little heretical. I know there's some preachers in the audience, and Bishop Gonzalez and others. The churches that are closing ought to close. They ought to close because they failed to protect the community when we were vulnerable. The Bible says judgment begins at the house of God. That's where we ought to start the conversation. What did we do to fail as leaders to protect the community from this onslaught? And I don't know that many people say it happened overnight and we didn't see it coming. I don't know that we didn't see it coming. What I believe is that too many people saw the benefit for themselves in allowing it to happen.
Well, there is complexity there, though, right? I mean, I've interviewed any number of people who, homeowners who were longtime African-American homeowners in the neighborhood, who were ready to move and were living in old houses that they couldn't keep up with, and their lives were improved by selling their house. And I think of a realtor I interviewed. Black realtor in Bed-Stuy, rooted in the community, he's been here for a very long time. And he said he would go on a block, and his whole thing was he wanted to sell, if he was gonna help somebody sell the house, he wanted to help him sell it to a black person. That's illegal, by the way, but this is what he said. He said that he would someone would hire him, they'd have an open house, the neighbors would come, and they would complain to the seller, like, I can't believe you do this, you're selling, this is awful. And then at the end of the open house, as he was leaving, invariably one of them would pull him aside and say, how much do you think you'd get for my house? So there is some complexity here. And Michelle, you were trying to jump in. I want you to sort of help us think through the complexity of this.
Well, one of the things is that I remember when they were first going to build what's now called the Barclays Center, and there were promises made, and I don't know if anyone was around during that time. There was a lot of resistance from the community. And the promise that was made was, one, it was supposed to bring more jobs. I don't know about you, but I haven't really seen them. You know, that pays well. It was supposed to bring affordable housing, although the affordable housing really is not really affordable. But this is what that was supposed to bring, and that's what made the community accept it. But no one is holding these developers, no one's holding anyone accountable for it. So what you have is, just riding on the B-52, you just ride through it and you see all of these new condominiums, you see all of these new places, and if you happen to go in to see what's the rent, you realize those housing are not affordable. So there's this thing that's being built within our community, and it's happening in Flatbush too. On one hand, it's like, okay, well, maybe I could be part of this progress. But economically, they're saying, not you. You can't come here. You can't afford to be here. And that's that shutout. For me, that's the frustration, that here I am, having been born and raised in Brooklyn, I serve my community, I love my community, but yet I can't afford to live in my community. I can't afford to invest in my community for some sort of longevity. It is frustrating, which then requires people outside of our community to then come in and do the teaching, do the policing, do the social working, do the care. And this makes me angry.
Indeed.
So this Mike the Roundtable I was telling you about, they were sort of vanguard of the affordable wage. Affordable wage is a very important, very, very important thing. I am more interested in myself not having an affordable wage. I'm interested for myself, and I'm in the not-for-profit world, so I'm not in the fantasy world, is a flourishing wage. That means I have to make sure that I am part of the economic engine of New York. And going back to that, is that it, you're right, it didn't happen overnight. It's folks are being driven out of the community for a lot of reasons. One of the reasons is they can't economically compete. Now, I'm just gonna look through the lens of my community. Now, I'm part of the Jewish community. So the Jewish community, for most people don't know, is a really complex community. Everyone looks on the outside and they say, well, you know, they all get along with each other. It doesn't necessarily happen because it's like any other community. So there's a growing Hasidic, ultra-Orthodox community coming out of Williamsburg, and they have a birth rate. Now, I'm not gonna stop them having a big birth rate. I'm also not going to stop them from practicing their religion the way they want to. That's what you call the complexity, you know? However, they've hit a wall now. They can't compete economically with the hipster community either, because they've now come down, moving down south towards Bed-Stuy, and they just hit a wall of hipsters and they can't compete. So where are they moving? Because they also have their property, they're moving north to the same place other folks are moving, into Rockland County, into Sullivan County, into Orange County, and they're moving into places where they just can't have the quality of life. And then what they're now doing is because of design, or maybe it's not so design, we don't fully understand that complexity, but they're not competing with the same folks they competed with a decade or two ago in Brooklyn for housing, because affordable housing is something we just not really have wrapped our heads around. And it is the single most important issue that we need to think about. Because I know that I grew up in City Housing Project here in Brooklyn. And I'm not quite sure where my parents could have lived as they were becoming part of New York, you know, after World War II, and it goes way back. And I'm not sure where they could have lived if it was not for affordable housing in the world of what we call the projects. And the projects meant that I also grew up with everybody who was everybody. I mean, I had a lens of the other person in my life that has stead me the rest of my life. So if we're living in communities where we can have the view of the other as being a partner rather than the enemy, that means that predicating for a future that's going to be full of conflict rather than being able to cooperate.
On the issue of complexity and how do we work together around these issues, throwing class into the mix. I know two young women who live in East New York with me now, who recently moved to New York. Before they moved, they were originally trying to live in Bed-Stuy. Coming from the West Coast, like, yeah, Bed-Stuy, that's where you're supposed to be. I mean, yeah, they're young women of color, they're kind of hip. This is the place to be. And they started shopping around for an apartment here. And they found a place they really liked. And the landlord, it was a multifamily home, which is a great deal of the affordable housing stock in New York City, is are people who own a home and rent out a couple of floors. And the owner, the realtor who was working for the owner said, oh yeah, great. You know, you're the kind of people we're looking for in this neighborhood. We want to improve the stock, I believe is the quote. And what the realtor was saying to them was, because you know, they're young and hip and middle class, of color, but young and hip and middle class. And this was sort of Eastern Bed-Stuy, where the rents were a little lower. Now, they said, I don't want to live with this person. I don't want to live with this person if they think this way. So they kept looking. But how do we think about that piece of it? That it's that there's also this pressure where we're of seeking out young, of sorting renters by who they are, not just by race, but by class. Whoever wants to go.
Well, that's not a new phenomenon. People have always sought out who they're comfortable with to commune with. I don't think the issue is when you have an intent to transform a community from one to another without having regard for what is there. And so if you own nobody is telling Aunt May who to rent the top floor of her brownstone to, and I ain't gonna try to start now. But when somebody comes and tries to steal Aunt May's deed,
yes.
That's all right, Bishop Gonzalez.
It's okay, go ahead.
The amen corner over there. Steals Aunt May's deed, or when the city sends Aunt May a notice that says you no longer qualify for the senior exemption because maybe you used one of your rooms for Airbnb and you got a little extra money, so now you don't qualify for the senior exemption in property taxes. So we're going to assess your property at the normal rate, which is thousands of dollars higher than you can afford. Oh yeah, by the way, your water bill is going to continue to increase 2-4% year over year to finish building a pipeline that won't be completed till after you have died. So when they are taking your pension money and investing it in developments and giving those contracts to companies that don't hire us to build in our community, we see how government plays a role there as well. So there is intersectionality. There's an interconnectivity here that I think we need to identify. Why can't we afford? Because our communities were underinvested for decades. Yes. Public school system, public health system, all of these systems which support communities. Now, in a community like Bed-Stuy, where we have an advanced civic infrastructure, where we can push back a little bit harder, where as opposed to what happened in Harlem, where Harlem was never really owned by black folks, just occupied by black, that's not the case in Bed-Stuy. Bed-Stuy is owned by black folks, which is why it's not happening as rapidly as they would like for the gentrification to happen, but it's happening. Because, in fact, Aunt May's deed is being stolen, and the property tax assessment is going up, and the water bills are going up. Oh, yeah, and by the way, she can't afford the grocery store anymore. Yeah, we live in a food desert, right? We live in a food desert. So you bring in high-priced food suppliers, we still live in a food desert. If you can't afford the higher quality food, you're still in the desert. So there's a holistic conversation that needs to happen that's more than just about how high the rent is going. It also needs to be all-encompassing. What is government doing or not doing? How are we protecting Aunt May? What is the district attorney doing in terms of going after predatory lenders and people who are stealing deeds and people who are doing these other things? But that's why I said this is the churches that are closing should close, because it was up to the leadership to inform, empower, and then galvanize the community around these threats before they actually crashed on the shore. And they did not do that. And so now we're dealing with all of the wreckage from the tidal wave, talking about how do we maintain? Well,
so, Michelle, you're trying to get in there, and we're running short on time, so I also want to prompt you to be in the solution space thinking about a Bed-Stuy resident and these large, overwhelming forces that the minister just got through describing. Where can that civic infrastructure that Bed-Stuy is rich in start to engage?
Well, it It starts with really thinking of all the power structures, because they're all connected. I wanted to add healthcare, because one of the problems is that Aunt May can't afford healthcare. And because Aunt May can't afford healthcare, she is selling a piece of her house, or she is giving up her income so that she can afford Medicaid to pay for her medication, to pay for the home health aid. This is very, very, very important. And we keep talking about Aunt May, and I'll make this quick, because you gotta remember that about 10,000 people turn 65 a day in the United States. So there's so much part of this thing that's happening is that we're not looking at the growing population and age group in our communities. So in terms of advocacy, it requires us to take care of our neighbors, not just me who's, in something a little lower age group, but to think about our people who are older, who may not be able to advocate, but to think about them. How is Aunt May doing? How is she, someone needs to speak for her. She needs it, or at least take her to the meetings and speak with her. And being able to really understand systems. It's not just about the individual. It's also looking at how can you advocate the church leaders, the community board leaders, the principals. All of those things come together. So while we're here, get involved. Making sure that, you sit at the table. My colleague told me, she's like, it's not just about sitting at the table, we are the table. And which means you don't have to be invited. Just go.
Rabbi, you're gonna get the last word. Thinking about solutions, I'm thinking about, so the stat that the minister was mentioning earlier that we were talking about backstage, if you look at the census numbers for Clinton, which is the part that is sort of Clinton Hill, between 2010 and 2013, there was something. You look at 18 to 34-year-old whites, there was something like 30,000. I don't remember the number off the top of my head anymore, but it was something like 20, 30, it was tens of thousands of people increase. In an area that small, that's an overwhelming population change. And I think, and I'm always stuck on, those folks are part of this community now too. How can they be engaged in organizing around this issue? That question or any other on how we move forward.
So I got a neat suspicion when we come around with the next census, it's gonna catch us all upside the head. Is that we're not going to believe how things have changed. We sort of anecdotally know it, but there's going to be stark figures that are going to tell a story that we're just not going to be comfortable with. And I agree with you, you just can't wait till those figures come out, because they won't come out until 2021, and that's a whole mess of years down the road. It may not be that far down the road, but look how fast it is all happening around us. So I'm a community organizer, that's really what I am. So I'm going to give that solution. We need to organize communities. We need to bring together those faith leaders and communities. That's why I'm part of faith groups throughout New York. We need to bring together community leads. We need to bring together elected officials. We need to bring together others who are concerned about the change, because the ultimate question is, who's happy about the change and who's unhappy about the change? And if you're unhappy about the change, you gotta come together and figure out some way you're gonna deal with it around your communities, because change is inevitable and it is happening. And unless the support systems are put in for those who are going to stay, because, it's interesting. I live in the Bronx today. I'll tell you an interesting thing. Once upon a time, I'm going to look through the lens of my community again. There was close to 700,000 Jewish people in the Bronx. Today there are 60,000. Things change. Well, when it was changing, when a lot of people left who could leave and took the money and ran and all kinds of stuff, and a lot of real estate people became very, very wealthy. Very, very wealthy, making that change happen. And ain't no different today. Well, there was a whole lot of people left behind who had miserable ends of their lives. Well, we have to make sure, going back to what Michelle was saying before, we can make sure that the seniors in this community, those who spent their lives building a community, should not have to look at the miserable end of a life. We have to organize, We have to have the support systems in place. We have to have the right people in place, and we have to take, you hit it right on the head, the responsibility for meeting the challenge rather than just saying, well, it's happening and I'm just going to sit back and let it happen.
We're going to have to leave it there. Thank you to all of our panelists.
Buy black. Buy black.
And those indeed will be the final words. Thank you to each of our panelists. From here, we will have a conversation with some of our elected officials about this same issue.
Thank you. Thank you. Can we give a round of applause once again to our panelists? Thank you very much. That was a lot to take in, wasn't it? So much richness, right? Awesome. And I know everyone is sitting down and they're listening to what all the panelists have to say. And I could tell some people just wanted to jump in, had some questions, had some feedback. So at this point, I see some heads shaking saying, that's right. So that's awesome. So right now, we're actually going to have a community building session where it's an opportunity for you to really speak to some dignitaries, you know, some people who are really doing a lot, whether it's through government, through local communities, and really just talk about the issue with them, because we don't want it to just be us sitting and listening, but we really want it to be a conversation, as we said. So right now, before we go, I want to just acknowledge one person who is here. We all know that one of our co-sponsors was Councilmember Robert E. Cornegie Jr. He wasn't able to be here. It's a long weekend. It's July 4th. You know, he went away with his family, but his chief of staff, Stephanie, is here. So we'd like to thank Stephanie for being here on behalf of the council member. We, you know, just appreciate all the effort, all the work that he continues to do. We also have our assembly member, Tremaine Wright, who is on her way. If anybody, you know, if you're watching the news, you know, there's a big thing in the state happening over, you know, our education system. So she had to go back to Albany because of a special session for a vote, but she's on her way here right now and is driving. We don't want to keep calling her. We don't want her to get into an accident. But her chief of staff, Naomi Hopkins, is here. So Naomi Hopkins is just going to share a few words on behalf of the assembly member. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce to you chief of staff for our assembly member, Tremaine Wright, Naomi Hopkins.
Thank you so much for coming. Unfortunately, as you already know, the assembly member is not here with us this evening. She, I believe, has just gotten back to Brooklyn. There was a special session called, you guys may have heard, by Governor Cuomo regarding mayoral control. The outcome of that is that we will continue to have mayoral control for the next 2 years, and then the Assembly and Senate will revisit it when it expires again. But we did have a few meetings, some tenant things going on, very important. The same things that we're here discussing tonight, this is real, gentrification is real. We have folks being pushed out as we speak. So we did need the assembly member to get there before she got here, but she does plan to arrive. So thank you again. We have a few things coming up this summer. One thing will be a moving screening, Hidden Figures. I have some flyers that I'm gonna leave at the table in the front. We've all seen the Academy Award-winning Hidden Figures, right? Right? So we're gonna screen that here. But what's really unique about this particular screening is that we're gonna have a free coding class for girls ages 13 to 18. So we invite the entire family to come out and see the movie, but we are targeting girls ages 13 to 18. So if you have any young women in your life, ages 13 to 18, even 12 to 19, we'll make some exceptions. Please contact our office. We're located here in Restoration Plaza in room 417. You can ask for me, Naomi, or anyone to RSVP.
So the first person that I would like to call back up onto the stage is Minister Kirsten John Foy. Minister Kirsten John Foy coming back up to the stage, who's gonna be part of this community building session. Can we give a round of applause for the minister? And also coming back up to the stage, and it's not every day that you have an open floor to ask, you know, a city government official any question that you wanna ask them, especially on tough conversations like this. So welcome, coming back up to the stage, our chair and commissioner, Carmelin P. Malelis. And of course, we have our facilitator who's coming back up, driving the conversation, Mr. Kai Wright.
So, and before we get started, just to follow up for the assembly members, so folks know what is going on, the governor has, of course, called a special session to discuss, I believe, mayoral control of the schools. Albany is functioning as usual. So,
Or not functioning
as usual. So the assembly member will join us if she is able to in the midst of that. But so for this part of the conversation, we're going to hear from you guys, get your questions in. I've got some questions of my own as well for the commissioner to really kind of get down to some brass tacks on things in terms of what is discrimination and what can be done about it. And I think the place I'd want to start is something that has bothered me for many years. The minister said that we shouldn't have been caught off guard. I'll be honest, I personally was caught off guard living in Bed-Stuy by the pace of the change. But the moment where I really got it was there was an apartment building couple just right across the intersection from me. One summer, at the beginning of the summer, you know, and I would always walk by it, and all of a sudden I just kept seeing mounds of people's furniture on the street, right, in evictions. And I knew that, right? But they just, every day, there would be a new pile of someone's life on the curb. And then, really within a few weeks, the building was being gutted. By the end of the summer, the building had been redone. And by late fall, it was full. And from the time that happened to the time I left Bed-Stuy, I never saw a non-white person walk into that building. And it was 100% black before that. And I thought, this cannot have been coincidence, what I just witnessed. So that kind of scenario, where you see that, and you see that mass numbers, because we're talking about, you know, that must have been a couple of dozen apartments that flipped. How do we understand intervening in that? What kind of, if that was racial steering, what might that racial steering have looked like, and what could have been done?
Sure. You know, and I think this also kind of goes to the example that you were talking about during the last panel of, I think, you know, the two women possibly experiencing some sort of, like, I think you called it like the landlord kind of sorting goes on with people, not just based on race, but also by income or economic status, etc. And so I see, you know, when you see that the demographics of a neighborhood are changing and you see, okay, these brand new buildings are going up and hello, all of a sudden, all the people who are filling these buildings, hey, they don't even look like me. I think those raise some flags, right? That this sort of sorting or profiling or that some type of discrimination might be occurring. And there's different types of discrimination, I think, that these flags that go up. One type is certainly something that we consider a lawful source of income discrimination under the city human rights law. So we're lucky that in New York City, as of 2008, we have had protections against people being discriminated against in housing because they're paying for their housing with some form of government assistance. It shouldn't matter how you're paying for your housing. If you're using a link voucher, a Section 8 voucher, or a HASA voucher, if you're a veteran and you have a veteran's benefit, it shouldn't matter how you're paying for your housing. You should be able to get that housing. And so when we see that there are incidents of like these new housing developments going up and that the population who's living in them is not including what we would think would be, you know, natural constituency from that particular region, we think, hey, one possible area of discrimination that we think could be occurring is lawful source of income. That's an area that we've been really focusing a lot of the agency's attention on because, especially when we're talking about housing, if you have the ability to get housing because you have a voucher, you should be in housing. And if you're experiencing that type of discrimination, it could be with a broker, it could be with the actual housing provider or the landlord, we want you to call the Commission on Human Rights. We've quadrupled the number of cases we did in the first year I was at the Commission, and we've increased even that number last year because we know that this is happening and it shouldn't be happening.
What are the, for that particular form of bias, what are, where is the place of intervention? Because I cannot tell you how common that is. I mean, how casual I hear people discuss. And I know real estate brokers who will specialize in, hey, listen, I'll get you a tenant that doesn't have, that isn't Section 8, and you don't have to have any, get your hands dirty in it, don't worry about it. I've had people recommend to me, hey, you know, you should call this person, they'll make sure you don't get a Section 8 tenant. Where's the point of intervention in that?
So I'm going to say, when people hear that, when they have that experience, or if you're just hearing it anecdotally from somebody that you know, call the commission. And I say this because what we've really built up in the last 2 years as well is a testing program. And this is particularly what we do. We hear about this, someone gives us a tip, sometimes a commissioner calls us, or sometimes we hear from an elected official, or sometimes we hear from a faith leader, and they say, hey, we know that there's this, you know, brokerage that's turning people away, or that's saying, you know what, you should be applying for housing here, you should be applying for housing here because you're paying with some sort of rental assistance. We will use our testing program, we'll send in people to test and make sure that if they are in fact breaking the law, that we're going to initiate a complaint against them. There'll be a commission-initiated investigation, and we will bring them to bear.
So that's exciting. To go back to my apartment building that flipped story, I, not as someone who was renting there, but who saw, wow, that building is 100% white and it was 100% black 6 months ago. I could have called the commission and said, hey, this address, I think there's something fishy happening.
Absolutely, and something I want to stress is that, you know, a lot of the times, the people who are, unfortunately, the victims of this type of discrimination, you got a lot going on in your life. You don't have time, necessarily, to put your name out there, put your name on a complaint and go through the litigation. We understand that. We still want to get the people, though, who are discriminating. That's why the commission has the power to initiate investigations and to push forward complaints even without somebody coming forward and putting their name in a complaint.
So we want to be able to get you guys in here. I think what's going to happen is folks are just going to raise their hands and we're going to come around with the mic with your questions. So be getting yourselves ready. Quickly, Minister, on this, I saw you nodding when I was talking about this. Do you want to chime in just quickly on how people can interrupt this kind of discrimination?
Yeah, I think part of where we need to build up our defenses is in the, you know, the legal system. Housing is civil. So I'm glad to hear about what the commission is doing under Commissioner Malalas. I think there's more that can be done. The mayor has tried to fund legal services for people in housing court. There are things that need to be done to protect tenants who fight back against landlords. There's a blacklist. And if you go to court, you have the nerve to fight back against your landlord. When you're ready to move, you're on a blacklist, you're blacklisted. So every realtor and every, you know, Tom, Dick, and Harry that's trying to, you know, push apartments, sees your name as a troublemaker. Sees your name as somebody that's willing to exercise their rights because you're on that list. So I think we need to do stuff. I don't know if this is something the commission can look into, something the city can do through other agencies and mechanisms. We need to look into how we dismantle the aggressive machinations of the real estate industry. And one of the ways they do is by blacklisting people who stand up and fight back against landlords.
You know, and just to emphasize, I mean, that's one of the reasons why the power of the commission to initiate investigations even without somebody's name being on a complaint is so important. Because people live there. People live there. They can be targeted. No one wants to be targeted where they actually live. So if we haven't, I mean, it's harder, granted, for smaller buildings, but for larger buildings or where there is a landlord or housing provider that has several buildings or several units, this power of the commission to initiate investigations on its own behalf is a very important one for that reason.
Okay.
Good evening. I am a part of the Coalition for Advancement for the Progress of East New York and Cypress Hills. An old-born Bed-Stuy baby from St. Mary's Hospital. First living quarters was Kings County. My second living quarters was Beds of a Brevard Projects, and now I'm part of Linden Plaza. But with the pastor, I want to let you know that I come out of the church where my old pastors worked the community of East New York, of Bed-Stuy, from Kingsborough on back. We did that. The new pastors are not trained to do that. They don't know how to work in the community, or they just don't want to. But my question to you is, how now, I just want to say to everyone, with your deeds for Aunt May, New York City Department of Finance does have that notice, a recorded document, so that if anybody goes out and touches your deeds, you will be notified. You get the alert. So that's New York City Department of Finance. But what my question is right now, and it's going to affect not just Bed-Stuy, this developing that you want to do at the Broadway Junction is going to destroy a lot of people. Because number one, New York City wants to build, think, a 23-story at 2440 Fulton Street so that the city agencies will come in. Then you want to revamp Broadway Junction. How are you going to protect those people? Ocean Hill, Brownsville, Bushwick, Bed-Stuy, East New York. How are you going to protect that when that project comes in there? Because that's a big project. And a lot of people are going to be displaced.
And I just want to say, as we move forward with questions, to keep in mind that for the Human Rights Commission, to keep sort of have to segregate in our minds here the questions about the mayor's development programs and mandatory inclusionary zoning and all of the things that I know all of us have a lot of questions about, and what the Human Rights Commission can do.
As Kai said, looking at, you know, the housing plans, that's not really within the commission's jurisdiction. That would be more something for one of our sister agencies. But that said, it's important to talk about this in this context, because what we do see and what often happens, and I think I'm trying to remember who it was in the panel that was talking about this. It might have been Rabbi Kaplan was saying, you know, there are these new builds, there are these new businesses, there are these new jobs, but who's getting these new jobs? And are the people in the community, are these the people that are getting these brand new jobs? That is actually within the commission's authority. So, you know, for instance, in my first year at the commission, two of the new pieces of legislation that were signed into law that we focused on, that we also had citywide campaigns on, and I'm hoping that folks who are here saw some of those campaigns, were on two very important protections that we have under the city human rights law. One is protecting people against discrimination in employment because of their credit history. And another is protecting against discrimination in employment because of somebody's criminal history. You know, the kind of, when people talk about ban the box type legislation. Obviously these are two protections that disproportionately affect both communities of color and women. And when I think about new builds or these new businesses that come up, these are also things that the Commission on Human Rights is very focused on, is thinking about, you know, are people in the communities getting the jobs that they should be getting when they're applying for those jobs? Are they being turned away illegally because of some factor, whether it's race or national origin, how they look, their skin color, or because they have issues with their credit history, which is frankly irrelevant for purposes of employment, or because there are issues with regards to criminal history, and our employers actually thinking through these issues in a way that they are required to think about them under the law. So I mean, I think in answer to your question, while we don't squarely think necessarily, it's not squarely within our jurisdiction to be thinking about the planning itself, we do think very much about when there are new jobs or new employers in the area, but people in the area are not getting those jobs.
But thinking about just the geo-targeting part of it, that does the commission sort of either have a system for noticing if there's a particular neighborhood where a lot of pushback, I'm trying to build on where the spirit of where I think you're talking about, is that there's a place like Brownsville and in and around Broadway Junction, is gonna be really at risk. When they build that, is there any system for noticing if there's going to be a trend of discrimination in that area?
Well, for the Commission on Human Rights, I mean, we are still, by city standards, we're still a very small agency. You know, when I first got to the Commission 2.5 years ago, we had 55 people across the entire agency. That was community relations staff and civil law enforcement staff, etc. 55 people. In the last 2.5 years, we've grown considerably. You know, our first year we grew to 121 staff. Our second year, my second year there, 131 staff. We're getting 26 new staff in this upcoming fiscal year, because the new fiscal year begins in July. But we're still very much a small agency. And for me, what that means is that we rely on the strengths of relationships that we're able to create with communities like this, with houses of worship, with community-based organizations, with folks who are active in their communities. That's why for me, when I said, you know, earlier this evening, I want you to know my staff. I want you to know my staff because that's the way we're going to get the information. That's the way we're going to notice these trends. Because you're calling up people that you know at the Commission on Human Rights, or, you know, Kirsten is calling up the folks that he knows, or Bishop Soldata is calling us up, or whoever it is that we're creating relationships with is calling us up and saying, hey, you guys need to check this out.
Some of these pastors are going to have to get busy, I guess.
Hello, good evening. My name is Ramel Bradley. I'm from Brooklyn, New York, Clinton Hill area, a neighborhood that's changed completely. And I have to agree with the mother back here. She spoke about the elders, you know, and what they used to do and how they used to get out and around. And I've been listening to you all. I've heard insults from other churches. And I've gotten a lot of knowledge tonight on what's going on, but I've gotten no answers on solutions. I've heard call a commission, does nothing. I've heard this is what's happening, that these buildings are going up, but no solutions. You know, everybody's so smart, and forgive me, I'm a little bit upset, but everybody's so smart, but I'm out here trying to figure out what to do. I've had a councilwoman from District 35. You know, we have a, I'm sorry? Yes. You know, I've been out here, I've been going to this place, that place, City Hall, and then I've had the councilwoman, Lori Cumbo, come to my street, my block, when we're having a street festival, and take photos and look good. When my grandmother's had a church for 25 years, and I introduced myself personally, asked her what can I do, what jobs are available, let her know who I am, my resume, you know, all good things. She gives me a phone number, I reach out this way, I reach out that way, social media, no answers, no response, no replies. I come out tonight, I need some answers, I need some solutions. I get a lot of knowledge. I need to know what I need to do to change things. Who do I need to speak to that's gonna change things? The mother back here just spoke about the project that's about to be done. It hasn't happened yet. We've heard today about how, you know, the Brooklyn, the Barclays Center, how that went up and this happened and that happened and this shouldn't happen, blah, 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 blah. But now we have something that's happening. What do we do to stop it? Because I feel like I'm gonna leave here and still feel the same way I felt when I came here, still have no answers, still go back to next week and a week after that, go to the next council meeting and hear a lot more information, take a lot more notes. But I need some solutions.
Let me ask you this. Because I have a question for you. I want to know you want to know what to do. Can you give us something specific that you feel like you haven't gotten an answer to here or elsewhere? This problem, this specific thing, I would like to make impact on that thing. What do I do? Is there something like that in Clinton Hill that you can name that we can try to get more specific for you on?
Well, number one, jobs. If I can't go to a councilwoman who works in my district, say, hey, I'm unemployed, I'm looking for work, how do I get work? And they say to me, here's my phone number, reach out to me, and then I hear nothing, that's not a solution for me. If the same way everyone feels, you know, you walk down the street, you see these high rises, I live it, I walk through it every single day of my life. I feel differently when I walk into the bodega who's owned by someone else, or the gourmet place, or the high rise, blah, 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 and people don't treat me the way I should be treated, and I've been living there my whole life, way longer than all these other people. I mean, what do we do? Well, do I go make a complaint to the high rise and
let me just say, brother, I feel your pain.
Yes.
I don't know what your problem is for me to provide the solution you're looking for. Because there have been solutions provided tonight. I know I've spoken on solutions provided tonight. But I don't know what specifically the problem you're looking to solve is.
Well, let me name one of the things he did say.
Is it gentrification? Is it unemployment? Is it what? Because until we know what the problem you're looking to solve is, we can't provide you the specific answer you want.
Let me touch on one of the things that you said, right? So I can't provide you with a job. What I can say is, if you feel like you have applied for a job and you haven't gotten that job because you're black or because of your ethnic background or because of your religion or because of, you know, any of the number of categories that are protected under the human rights law, I'm going to say, tonight before you leave, I will connect you with one of our lawyers here and they will call you back. One of the things you did raise too is you should not feel like a stranger in your own neighborhood. Right? So if you are feeling disrespected because you're going to a bodega or you're going to some gourmet eatery or whatever it is, and again, you know, you believe that you think that you're being treated differently or you're being disrespected or you're being served last or you're being ignored because, again, of a category of protection under the city human rights law, race. It could be because of your, a language that you speak. It could be because of the color of your skin, whatever it is. But a category of protection under the city human rights law, that's not okay either. I will also connect you tonight with one of our lawyers and they will give you a call back tomorrow. Because that's not right. You should not be made to feel uncomfortable in your own neighborhood. That's precisely the sort of things that the city human rights law is meant to protect. But actually getting you a job outside of an area of, you know, outside of an experience of discrimination, that unfortunately is not within something that I, as the commissioner for the Commission on Human Rights, could address.
Go to NewYorkCity.gov. Go to the Workforce Development Portal. Upload your resume to the New York City Workforce Development Commission. And they will put your resume into a pool from which they draw from. So if there is a project happening in your community where the developer has agreed to hire locally, the first place they go to is that pool. And if you fall into that catchment area, wherever they're building, and your resume is on point or you qualify, whatever it is, there's a, like every other employment, there's a screening process, interview, all that other stuff. If you go into that pool, your resume will float to the top of the pile in their system. But you have to follow up. So you upload your resume and you contact them and you make sure that they know that you are not just going through the motions, but that you want to come down and speak to them as well about whatever other opportunities, employment opportunities, that the city is coordinating with private industry. Whether it's tech, they have thousands of jobs that they are filling for tech companies, whether it's construction or any other industry. A lot of what's happening now is being driven by entrepreneurship. So I don't know if you have a history in hospitality or whatever. Maybe you have a bartender's license, and there are bars popping up everywhere. That's one place you can go. If your council person is not responsive enough, the other place you can go is the voting booth. That's part of how we solve the problem. Part of how you solve the problem is doing what you're doing right now. It's not being disconnected, though. It's not what are y'all doing, it's what are we doing. Because I, nor the commissioner, can do anything in and of ourselves.
If you're being discriminated against, either because of where you're shopping or where your job, how are we protected?
So the city is considered to have one of the most robust human rights laws in the country because we have over 22 areas of protection.
So you can't list them all.
I can try, but I will say for purposes of completeness, I would go to our website and check it out. Because also there are additional protections you have in employment that you don't necessarily have in housing. There's additional things that you have in housing that you don't have in employment, and you know, kind of all around. So I would check that we have the usual protections that one would think of when they think of civil rights or human rights laws, like age, religion. Age, religion, gender, race, national origin. We also have ones. We have ones that are not found in many of the other jurisdictions, like sexual orientation, gender identity, and gender expression. We also protect against things in employment, like I said earlier, protections against discrimination based on criminal history or credit history. We have protections against people being discriminated against because they're a survivor of domestic violence or sexual assault or other related sex offenses. We have protections against being discriminated against because you're a caregiver. So if you are taking care of a minor child or you're taking care of somebody with a disability in your home and you're being discriminated against in employment, you can't do that here in New York City either.
Family status as well, right?
Well, it's really formed as caregiver.
Okay.
In housing, you can't be discriminated against because you have children. Or you can't be discriminated against because you're married or unmarried. You also can't be discriminated against in housing because, again, how you're paying for your housing, if it's some sort of lawful source of income. You can't be discriminated against in housing because of what your lawful occupation is. I'm trying to think of what other areas of protection. Because you're unemployed, you can't be discriminated against because someone says, hey, you're unemployed, that means you're a terrible worker, so no job for you. That's illegal under the law. There are several. I'm going to have to study up for the next time.
Okay.
I'm with Kai.
So, but that's, I just want to give people a sense because I appreciate the frustration about specifics. So if there's to make sure we know that here's one solution. If you have felt discriminated against or seen someone else discriminated against, it sounds like, on any of these categories, call the commissioner.
Let me also add this. I just want to say I really do appreciate your comments. And I say that because you're being engaged in this, as Kirsten was saying. And one of the things that we need at the Commission on Human Rights is to actually hear from people in the community. That's how we create our initiatives. That's how we form our campaigns. That's how we figure out how we can actually be responsive to community needs. That's how we came up with this campaign. After the election, there was an increase in complaints of discrimination at the Commission. Like I said, in 2016, our reporting at the agency increased by 60%. So we gathered together different roundtable discussion groups, you know, about 10 of them, with people from across the city. And as a result of those groups, people said, you know what? One, you really need to have this public info campaign so people know how to reach the commission. People need to know what their rights are. They identified specific areas of, you know, can I talk Spanish in public? And can somebody shush me and say, hey, get out of here? No, people can't do that. That's why it's one of the videos that we have as part of the campaign. Somebody said, can somebody discriminate against me because, you know, my name on a resume and, you know, either it sounds ethnic or because they're racially stereotyping me. No, you can't discriminate against somebody because of that. That's illegal under our law. That's another example that we have as part of the campaign. We want people to tell us what they're experiencing and what issues that they have. We're not always going to be able to be the agency to resolve them, but it helps us form our programming. So thank you.
Thank you. My name is Jacques Walcott. I hear my brother's pain because I have experienced the same thing. What I am seeing is a lack of leadership. There is no leadership. We're seeing a lot of talking heads, a lot of people are sharing information, but there is no specific leadership. Nobody that can bring us together under some common banner that we all can get up together and say no to X, Y, or Z. There's a dearth of leadership. And I mean, everywhere we go, I've been to many of these meetings. And like my brother said, we hear a lot of information, but there is no transformation. And I believe it's a lack of leadership. Thank you.
Unless somebody wants to respond,
I think that's kind of the problem, that we're looking for leadership and we're not tapping into our own power. A lot of what you're talking about, it starts with the community meetings, the community board meetings. In the community board meetings, there are committees. There's the senior committee, the building committee, the housing committee, the employment committee. You got to get involved. This building that you're talking about, ma'am, did not get there before it went through the community board. And the community board has to build in getting people, the average Joe, getting the people who are interested and being part of that committee. Once they're being part about it, then it takes another part, commitment. We have the attention span of 5 minutes. This is not something that's going to be erased in 5 minutes. It takes commitment of time, energy. You don't need a leader, you need an agenda. Yes. What is it that's important to me? This is what I need. I need this, this is the most important, this is the second most important, this is the third most important to me. How are we going to work on it? Okay, Mr. Such and Such, you deal with this. Such and Such, you deal with that. You deal with this. You parcel it out. We all have busy lives. Everyone takes a piece of it. We're equally responsible to ourselves and to each other. So, don't look for a leader. Don't look for the table. Make the table. Be the table. And be committed to it.
So, we're winding down, and I want to make sure everybody who has questions about the commission's work has a chance to ask them. I do want to say that I want to acknowledge all of the folks on this question of leadership and organizing, because, you know, I think one of the challenges we have in the city is that people have organized and power hasn't responded, particularly on this issue. And I think there's a lot of people who are frustrated because of that. And so I think that is meaningful. That said, with the time we've got remaining, I really want to urge folks who have questions for the commissioner about the commission's work on discrimination to make sure they get those asked.
Hi, my name is May. I'm also from Clinton Hill, born and raised, so I feel your frustration. I also wanted to make a point in regard to going to nyc.gov. There's a really good apprenticeship program going on and working class blue collar jobs, where there's a huge gap for that, and they are training young people. My cousin went into the program about 5 years ago. She's making about $110,000 a year. So I'm just letting you know that it's a really important, she's a carpenter and she's union and everything. It's a really important resource. I don't know why it's not spread out in our communities more, but I'm here giving it to you all, word of mouth, just so you all know. I think a lot of times we get caught up in this American dream and this elitist ideology of what it means to be American in this country. And sometimes that means, you know, going through, you know, pillars of institutions that don't quite educate us. They just teach us to sink it, to absorb and regurgitate knowledge, but not apply that. And not to think critically in our lives, especially in the lens that we have as marginalized Black people in this country. And I think that, like, it's really important that you check that out. And I'm really sorry about your frustration, because I feel the same as well. I'm from Clinton Hill. I know about Lori Cumbo. That's why I'm mad at Lori Cumbo, because that's my old district, even though this is my district. What I do want to say is that I'm happy that we're having this dialogue right now. I think this is the first time in a long time that I've actually seen a contingent of community leaders coming forth and really asking about the things that are too taboo to talk about in our communities, especially with this onslaught of gentrification. I think it's really important when we talk about how things change in New York. We apply it as though this is an equal playing ground. I think we need to be very specific about the Black community. We need to be specific about the blighting of urban Black communities. We need to be specific about gentrification and how that's the way has been paid for that through redlining. I am of not only the African-American diaspora, but also of the Afro-Caribbean diaspora. My grandparents immigrated to Crown Heights in 1940, and they were able to purchase a home because of the loophole of not being an African-American. We weren't allowed to purchase homes in this community at one time. And what I do appreciate is that we have a strong community here of the Caribbean diaspora that not only came here because they were financially literate in their own countries and took that and applied that to buying up property here, but they intermarried with African Americans and taught us what our own school systems and what our own government and our own societies don't teach. I don't have questions.
So just because time is short, I want to make sure everybody gets a chance. Do you have a question for the commissioner?
I don't have a question. I just think that we should be very specific when we're talking about gentrification and how it's not. There's a big difference between white flight and gentrification. And I just wanted to put that out there as we go forward
for
and
that.
We continue to have these conversations, because I think we're afraid to use certain language. We've been so conditioned to use specific language for so long that erases our specific experience.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you ask, so what's the website again, please?
It's newyorkcity.gov. It's Workforce One, but it's under the apprenticeship program.
So I just want to say quickly, I thank you for your comments, and you know, as I said earlier, this is meant to be the first of hopefully very many more conversations. I say that as the head of this agency, the Commission on Human Rights. You know, when we were sitting in the back, kind of chatting a little bit and preparing for tonight's program, I asked some of the panelists. I said, so what do you think of the fact that this is government putting together this program? And I'll leave it to them to say what their responses were. But for me, it's significant. I didn't come from government. This is my first time going into government, taking on this role. And I particularly took on this role because I do think that government has a responsibility to take on some of these hard topics and to have these open conversations. I don't think it happens enough in government. And if I'm going to be the head of an agency, I want to be that agency head that says, okay, these are not easy conversations for communities to have, but your government, and it's your responsibility to do that. I think it's the only way, as I had this agency that takes on discrimination and harassment, we can't really talk about what are the real causes of racism or Islamophobia or white supremacy or any of these things if we don't have kind of honest and open discussions like this. So what I'm saying to you is thank you for your comments. This is the first of hopefully many discussions, and I hope you will continue to come out.
What happens when complaints get, I guess you use the phrase initiate a complaint or initiate an investigation? Where does it go from there?
So when a complaint comes in from the public, if somebody comes in to file a complaint, basically what happens is they file it with the Commission's Law Enforcement Bureau. That's the civil law enforcement arm of the agency. They might file a complaint there. At that point in time, the Law Enforcement Bureau is looking at that and investigating the allegations of that complaint. And at that point in time, the Law Enforcement Bureau is kind of acting as like a neutral investigator. They're interviewing the person who filed the complaint. They're interviewing the entities which the complaint is against, also called the respondents. They might be also interviewing some witnesses. They're trying to find out if under our law, there would be probable cause, not the criminal standard, but our standard under the city human rights law, probable cause that the discriminatory act actually occurred. If they find that there was probable cause, then that the Law Enforcement Bureau turns into a prosecutorial arm of the agency. And that case could then get referred to an administrative law judge at the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings, another city agency, to go through a full trial on the merits of that. It can go through that process. The ALJ would then write up a report and recommendation as to whether or not they thought there was any liability, if there should be any damages, if there should be any sort of civil penalties under the law, and then that would then come back to the Commission on Human Rights, to my office, the office of the chair, for a final decision and order as to liability and damages and any sort of civil penalties. Now, if the complaint's not coming out from the public, if the complaint is just, if we receive information from the public and based on the information we receive, the deputy commissioner for the Law Enforcement Bureau or the assistant commissioner for the Law Enforcement Bureau decides, you know what, we're going to take this on even without having a complaint come forward. So we're going to, as the agency, affirmatively investigate this claim. It skips that whole initial process of neutral investigation, and it goes, there's already an assumption of probable cause of discrimination, and then it follows the rest of the path that I described. There's also a really great infographic. If you take a look, there's a little...
Because that's a lot of information.
Right.
There's a little cartoon and an infographic available on the website. Check it out.
What's the web address?
www.nyc.gov/human rights.
It's up here.
Yes.
Please.
I wanted to know, did you have oversight for like food trucks and food carts? Because I know that's on a little bit different than restaurants and business owners on a larger scale discriminate against their patrons. I wanted to know if you had any oversight over that. And then I also wanted to see if you could speak about what's the difference in a workplace between discrimination and the amount of microaggressions that individuals deal with, and how do you go about addressing those, and how do we go about reporting that, and as well, what is the teeth that your agency provides?
Spectacular question.
Sure, okay. So with regards to, you know, the question about food trucks and things of that nature, there is a difference between looking at an entity as an employer and looking at an entity as a business for purposes of, you know, interacting with them as a public accommodation or as a business. If you're interacting with, I'm just going to use the food truck example. If you're interacting with the food truck as a customer, that is covered under the City Human Rights Law. If you're being treated differently, if they're not serving you, if they're calling your names, if they're calling you epithets, that's covered under the City Human Rights Law. Complain about that, call us. For in employment, as employers are considered, for purposes of most of the provisions of the City Human Rights Law, employers have to have 4 or more employees. So if you have a food truck and it's, you know, one person or 2 people, so I guess somebody would have to be complaining, right? 2 people, and we always include the owner, that likely would not be covered under the City Human Rights Law. But if the owner owns, you know, however many food trucks and has however many employees, that could be covered under the City Human Rights Law. And then with your second question, I have to say, you know, I have really mixed feelings about the term microaggressions, because in my mind it kind of, you know, diminishes almost the experiences, all the things that people describe as microaggressions. I just think of as those are aggressions.
Just an aggression. Aggressions.
And somehow the term microaggression came to be, and I'm not going to fully critique it because I really don't know the, you know, etymology of where that came from or anything like that. But in my mind, I hear about these things, or when people are talking to me about discrimination in the workplace. And you all should know, before I came into government, my background was actually as an advocate for employees. So my, you know, 10 years prior to coming to government was I was advocating on behalf of employees. And when people would talk about things as microaggressions, I would just say, that's straight up discrimination, right? So if you're being belittled, if you're being called names, if you're being kept out of meetings, if you're being at all treated differently under our city standard, it's being treated less well because of your membership in a protected class, that could be discrimination under the City Human Rights Law.
So I mean, would the message then be, don't worry about sorting it out, call you and you'll figure out whether it's,
exactly,
feelings
exactly
at all, call.
Exactly. 311, ask for human rights, 718-722-3131, give us a call.
We are at the wire, one last question, as fast as you can ask it.
Okay, my name is Sylvia and I have a specific question about your jurisdiction over housing rights and discrimination. And so you said you take suggestions from the community, and I think something that came out in the comments of the woman in front of me and also the moderator was a lot of people believe when neighborhoods are being rezoned and there's development that there's going to be displacement and it's going to be racially disparate, but actually the city housing and planning agencies have no opinion on that because we don't collect data on it. So could your agency study the racially disparate impacts of city zoning and housing policy in addition to real estate discrimination and things like that?
So do you conduct studies of, first off, at all, and then secondly, would you conduct this kind of study?
Can you investigate
the city? Yes.
So yes, Kirsten, wait, she can investigate the city is what
to answer Kirsten's question. Kirsten was asking me with a smirk, can I investigate other city agencies? The answer to that is simply yes. I mean, one of the reasons that the City Human Rights Law is so powerful is because we do have jurisdiction not just over private employers, but over a lot of city agencies. So one, I would note that, you know, I mentioned earlier kind of an area of protection that a lot of people don't know is we have jurisdiction over bias-based profiling by law enforcement. So if somebody thinks that they're being treated differently by NYPD because of their membership in a protected class, that could form the basis of a complaint at the City Human Rights Law, at the City Human Rights Commission. Also, for purposes of employment or as public accommodations, we also have jurisdiction over other city agencies. With regards to your question, the question is, are we currently conducting those types of studies? The answer to that question would be no. If the question is, could we be looking at disparate impact in housing because of some of the issues of displacement that we've talked about? Yes, we could, absolutely. And that's part of, again, why I would say, you know, we have these conversations or we have these types of gatherings because we want to identify what we, as a small city agency, should be focusing our resources on and what areas of research or study we should be looking at.
Well, that sounds like an invitation for organizing to pressure you to do so. We have to leave it there. I want to make sure we do follow up before we go on the one question that keeps coming up, deed theft, because it is a very big deal. Is there anything that you would say to people in terms of what they could do around that and your agency?
So I'm sure that there's other agencies that deal with the theft portion of deed theft, but if people are being targeted, if specific communities or individuals are being targeted because of their race or because, you know, people think, you know what, I think that this is an enclave of X type of immigrant community or people where their immigration status is in question or whatever the reason is, again, the protected category under the law. If people are being targeted for deed theft because of their membership in a protected category, yes, that would fall within the city human rights law.
We will leave it there. You are invited to continue reaching out to the commission, certainly report any discrimination you see. Thank you to both of our panelists tonight, to all of our panelists tonight, and to Minister Floyd, and to the commissioner.
Thank you all for coming.
She sends another sense of regret because she is busy voting in the assembly now. Thanks so much.
Before you all go, I also want to remind you of our contact information. You can file a complaint on our website, nyc.gov/human rights. You can also call 718-722-3131. And the commission has community service centers in each borough. So you don't always have to come to Manhattan. Whichever borough you live in, Staten Island, Queens, Bronx, Brooklyn, you have a community service center in your borough. We'd like to once again thank the Billie Holiday Theater for having us, and thank you all for joining us and our co-sponsors. Once again, remember, you have rights in New York City.